Hey there. So I've been thinking today, in a little while I'm going over to Luke and Logan's house. And Luke and Logan are two of my four grandsons. They are 6 and 4, and they light up my world. If you follow me on Facebook, you probably have seen lots of cool pictures of different kinds of things that we do together. And so here they are. Here's a picture of Luke and Logan. And, well, if I can get it in the camera. And so one of the things that I tend to think about with these two, as I'm sure you do with your classroom students, maybe your own children, your grandchildren, or maybe even adults that you spend time mentoring, is you probably want to think about how do I move them along a continuum towards positive maturation, but not have to do it from a place of direct coaching or have to do it from a place of finding the mistakes and saying, okay, this is where you blew it. Now, this is what we're going to do next time. And out of that comes growth. Instead, it's kind of cool to use an affective, positive kind of technique called blossoming. And what blossoming does is it takes positive feedback to develop good behavior, character, or move a child or an adult learner forward in a developmental continuum. This technique works for adults or kids, and there's a couple reasons why it works. First of all, the definition in itself of blossoming, it can be a definition that has to do with gardening, which is a lot like what we do when we mentor, isn't it? So it has to do with tilling the soil and pruning and doing whatever it takes to make sure that we get that beautiful blossom, that beautiful flowering fruit of a plant. And blossoming, when you're talking about humans or individuals, works in much the same way. The definition is that it's a blossoming is to mature or develop in a promising and healthy way, coming out of the dictionary. And I like to think of it for those of us that are sowing into people's lives, that we're constantly thinking through what is the end product or the outcome that we want to happen. Blossoming is a way to use really positive kinds of experiences and conversation and move them along the continuum. And so it's got 5 E's. That's the best way to remember it. It's got these 5 E's of blossoming. And you can see here, if I can get the paper straight, examine, expose, emotion, expect, and endear. And these are going to be the different aspects of blossoming. And blossoming, I put it with 5 E's just so that it'd be easier to remember. But the main thing that it works on is this idea of expectation. So it works because it not only connects with an individual's head, so cognitively they can think about through metacognition, what is it that my mentor expects of me or my parent expects of me? So there's that knowledge component, but there's also very much a heart component, and it really looks at the heart. And the heart has a lot to do with our soul, or has a lot to do with feelings and that kind of thing. But the secret ingredient to blossoming is a spiritual perspective of it. It deals with expectations or calling into the future, being able to call that which is not as though it were. Expectations and faith in the individual and what you see that through the behavior that you see now, the path that you see that it's going to take them through, the outcome. And by connecting the individual or the learner that you're working with, child or adult, to that place in the future, it gives a concrete kind of path that's attached to the heart, the head, and the spiritual aspects of getting them there. And so I really like it because it has such a positive piece to it. So let's kind of go through the different aspects of blossoming. So the first one is examine. Hey, this works in reverse. It's kind of tough. And with examine, what you want to do is you want to pay close attention to what the individual is doing. So you're watching the kids, you're watching the adult, and you're kind of looking for the opportunity to see what is the behavior that I want to see replicated. So what is it that they're doing right? It's sort of, in some educational circles, we call this catch them being good, right? So you're looking at, wow, I would really like to see more of that behavior. That's what we want to go for, this right here. Once you see it, then what you're going to do is you're actually going to expose it. So you want to call out what they did specifically. Now, a lot of times when we're mentoring or we're coaching, we have the tendency to go, good job, way to go, love it. I mean, as a teacher, you might do this for your kids all the time. You're giving them positive reinforcement. You're saying, good job, you know. The problem with that is that there's not any specificity. And without the specificity, sometimes the message isn't lasting. They're not able to consider what you're saying. Sometimes they don't even know. They can't connect it to the behavior itself that you're trying to call forth. So you don't want to do it from a cheerleader's perspective. When you find fruit in their life, you want to call that out in a very specific way. So, hey, you know, Luke, I really like the way that you were just treating your brother right then. What I saw you doing is that instead of getting angry and just throwing things or hitting, you actually spoke to him and reasoned with him. And then you were able to not only divert his attention, but you gave him another toy in exchange for the one that you wanted to play with. So I'm very specifically talking about the behavior that I want to see replicated. So the first one is examine, where I'm looking for fruit, right? The second one is expose, and that's where I see the fruit, but I'm going to talk to the individual about what I see in a very, very specific way. You have a much greater chance of seeing that behavior replicated when you handle it in that same way. Now, this is where you're going to get it to stick, and it's the stickiness piece of it. There's a place where you want head and heart to connect, so it's emotion. What you want to do right here, you want to expose, once you've examined and you've exposed, you're going to describe exactly how it makes you feel. So if I'm going back to the Luke and Logan piece again, I might say, wow, Luke, I really like the way that you just engaged with Logan there. That is exactly the way that you want to do this. I saw that when you were talking to him, what you said was that... instead of getting angry, instead of throwing things, instead of snatching things, you diverted his attention by giving him another toy. And then you told him specifically, you know, thank you so much. I'm going to play with this one. You play with this one. And then you gave an idea. You know how that makes me feel? That makes me so happy. What I can see is that you are really growing as a kid. I'm just so happy about that. And I'm really satisfied in the way that you handled that. So some type of emotion that you're going to talk about there and what this does is it really allows the behavior to become more memorable. And it also allows it to become available for recall is what cognitive psychology shows us. So tie it to emotion. And then after you do that, after you've examined, you've exposed, sorry, I wish I was smoother at that, and then you're going to go to the expectation. Now, this is really the spiritual aspect. You know, we've dealt with examine here, which is we're looking for fruit because we've been sowing seeds and we want to see something produced. Expose, aha, we see some fruit. And so we go in and we prune a little bit with the plant. We're going to talk about specifically what is it we want them to do. Then we're going to get to where it will be able to stick, because if you tie it to the heart, if you tie it to emotion, it's better for recall. Cognitive psychology tells us we'll be able to recall it up. So you tell them how it makes you feel. And then you're going to go into the expectation. And expectation in a lot of times is calling that which is not as though it were, which is a spiritual concept. It also has to do with the faith that you have in this individual. It's actually the part that gets left out. And so it's the part where you're moving them from where they are to where you want them to be in the future. So I usually add a piece in there, whether I'm working with adults or kids, that I say, you know what that tells me about you? That tells me that you're the kind of kid that will be able to be diplomatic. You'll be a peacemaker. You're going to be able to work with people and be able to help to get the best out of them without using anger or demeaning someone or talking down to them. And so what a peacemaker. What a peacemaker you are. And, you know, in the future, that could get you into all kinds of jobs. I know you had told me some of the careers that you wanted to be involved in. And so I'm really proud of you because I can see you're well on your way for that. The last piece, once you called it where it is, and I'll give you an adult example too, is then you would do endear. And endear is really important because it has to do with a lot of Maslow's hierarchy of needs of self-esteem, self-acceptance, that kind of thing. I usually will like appropriate touch, so I'll tousle their hair. If it's one of my kids or my grandchildren, I'll give them a hug. Maybe you pat someone on the shoulder or on the back. So some type of touch that is going to appropriate touch that, of course, will do an endearment piece of this. You know, the important thing to remember here is that just recognizing the behavior by saying, hey, good job, I like the way that you didn't scream this time when you were talking to Logan. All that really is a compliment, and it's not going to do anything to change the behavior of where they are and where you want them to be. It's that calling into the future, calling that which not is though it were. It's that speaking specifically through faith what it is that you want to change or where you see that it's going to be taking this child or this adult through what you've gotten to know. And it works great with adults too. You know, if you try it on each other, I've used it with teachers. And then afterwards, I'd say, tell me a little bit about that scenario, that little thing that we just did. How did that make you feel? And always, people just, sometimes they break down crying. Sometimes they talk about no one's really given me specific praise like that. And so use blossoming. Specifically praise the people that you are mentoring or the children that you are raising and move them from where they are to where you want them to be, where you feel their calling is. And you'll get forward momentum and amazing benefits. You'll see maturity in positive, healthy ways. Blossoming, great technique. All right. I'll see you online soon. Thanks.